just one more time, quietly. Settle ourselves in this moment. Get yourself comfortable in your seat. If you're standing, go ahead, take a seat. From the youngest child in here to the oldest. Just close your eyes for one moment. And Brigitte, sing that quietly one more time. Oh, how he loves us. Just the chorus. Lord, your love is nothing like ours. You love when we don't. You love even when we make mistakes, when we don't acknowledge you, when we don't even see you, when we mock, you love us. Your love is consistent, it's strong, never changes, it doesn't waver. When you correct us, it's in love. When you invite us, it's in love. I pray that we would have a revelation of that love in even greater ways. Lord, I pray for our children. I pray you pour out over them as they go to their classes. I pray over the teachers. I pray from one end of this church to the other, from every room, your love would permeate. And that through everything we do, whether it's worship, whether it's in our giving, in our talking with one another, through the prophetic, through teaching, through the classes, through our children, through everything that we do, our motivation would be your love. And that we would serve one another through that love, like you first loved us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for filling us. Thank you for reminding us of your love. And I pray your blessings over our children as they go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I am so grateful for his love. I could just stand here and smile, bask in it, as I watch 300 people leave the service. More, there's more leaving now. You know, this morning we're talking about taking up our identity and taking up our position and standing. And it always has to come from a position of love. God invites us through love. And I think that there's been a lie that has been carried in the church since the beginning in many ways, that God is a God of we have to do something and then he loves us. But God is a God that loves first. He is the one that pours out over. So everything that he invites us to is from a sense of love. Even when he says, stop sinning, It's from a place of love, and it's from a place of invitation. It's from a place that says, I know what will bring you life. So follow me so that you can have life. And really this morning, in a lot of ways, this is about Cornerstone. This is a prophetic, I believe, call for Cornerstone. But, you know, God doesn't ever just do something in one little area. So I have heard this go out. And I do have to say this. On Friday night, Tony, Joni, and I went to a small little pastoral event at Rob Holman's family church he has. And only a few number of people were there. And we had somebody who was, he was praying over pastors. And so we went, and he said, who's a pastor here? And, you know, I raised my hand. And he began to just kind of speak encouragement over the three of us. And what was amazing to me was it was a confirmation of what God is going to speak this morning. And he was saying, everything that he was saying was take up your position. And he was saying, stand in who you are and your identity. And I believe that God is calling us to that for this year. So it was a sweet blessing to have that. But when I think about CCF, and I'm thinking about what is God's call for Cornerstone? What does God have for Cornerstone? And I truly believe that we are called to be a light on a hill. And I truly believe that we are called to radically love and to love fearlessly. And I believe that we're called to love those that are especially on the margin, those that are especially broken, those that are especially lost, those that are in battles for their life. I believe that God, from the beginning of this church, has had a call on this church to the broken and to bring healing. I believe that when we love fearlessly, that means that we are going to love through walls that the church has erected for centuries. That means that we're going to love regardless of what somebody may look like or act like. That means that we're going to go beyond what I believe the church has gone beyond. I truly believe that it's time for the church to rise up and to be the love church that God has set forth in the beginning. And I believe that we truly are a part of that. And I believe that we're called to epitomize the upside-down kingdom of God. You know, there is something very, very special about this community. We are different. We are a diverse community. We are diverse in ethnicity. We are diverse in culture. We are diverse in language. We are diverse in socioeconomics. We are diverse in so many different ways. And we are, in many ways, very different from most of the churches around us. And I have to say this. I can say this without even, you know, worrying about anybody thinking like I'm, you know, saying something about myself. This church was like this long before I ever got here. This church has been moving in this direction for 30 plus years. I am just right here in these last four or five. But this church, this is what this church was founded on. This was the heart of this church, was for justice and for God's justice to roll down through this church. I believe that this is the time that we're going to reap those seeds that have been planted for years before. I believe that this is the time that God is saying, stand up and let's move. And you know, I have been thinking about this for last year, but especially at the end of this year, because I believe that in even greater ways we're called to this hurting, broken church. People. And as I began to think about this, you know, I began to think about the numbers that are in our church. Because, you know, we just went through finances. And which, by the way, can I tell you something? I'm going to print this out and let everybody read it. But one of the prophetic words that this man gave was, are y'all ready? He said, I believe that you have just recently gotten a new note on your church. And he said, God has already a plan to pay that off. Come on. Come on. And he said, and he goes, that note you didn't, he goes, you were having financial difficulty. This is a guy that knows nothing about us. And he said, and God wants you to know, He said, it's going to happen through your people. It's going to happen in miraculous ways. He goes, but get ready. You're going to burn that note. Come on. Come on. Your million-dollar man, Miss Cindy. Remember him? Anyway, so hold on. I lost my thought now. Oh, so, you know, we've gone through all this. You know, when you look at the numbers, and I got to be honest, I'm kind of lamenting to God, right? I'm like, God, I think this place is phenomenal. I think we got a call that's astounding. I see the diversity. All the things that I talked about, the beauty of it, I'm going, God, I see this. I think this place should be filled. Like, I think people should be coming out of the woodwork. I think we should have overflow rooms. I'm like, what is it? And God, in his beautiful way, and, you know, as much as I am ever able to hear from God, I heard him say this, and it's always submitted, but I heard him say, your assumption is because the church is big that I'm behind it. He goes, your assumption, he goes, that the church that is in the United States, and he said, and that everybody espouses that the bigger the church, the better the anointing. He goes, you are buying into that. And he goes, I have an upside down kingdom that looks different. And he said, I want you to go to Hebrews 11. I want you to study that. And then I want you to tell me about how many people followed those people that were my champions of the faith. And so I went into Hebrews 11 and I began to study it. And starting with Abel, well, Abel was murdered. Then we moved to Enoch. Well, Enoch was so righteous, he was just removed from earth. Enoch was, and then he wasn't, it says. He just was removed. Then we have Noah. He had entire cities watching him and mocking him as he built that ark. Entire cities were coming out going, you are a fool for what you're doing. And by the way, in the end, he had 8 in all that were saved in that ark with him. Then we move to Abraham. Well, Abram had a lot of followers. They were his family and his servants, and they relied on him economically. And then you move to verse 13, and it says, all of these people were living by faith when they died. We don't look at these verses. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. See, they had different eyes. They were not focused on what they got here and now. They were focused on who God is here and now. And they were focused on a land that was not yet. That doesn't mean we don't pray for things on this side, but it means that as we pray for things on this side, our eyes are focused on the promise that we have on the other side. So we think that when something doesn't happen here, that it's not going to be fulfilled. And God goes, no, that promise remains. My promise has come to pass. Whether this life or the next, my promises hold true and what I've promised come to pass. But we get caught in this land. We think this is it. And he goes, no, it is, but it's not. It's fullness on this side. So then you look at Moses. Well, he was in the Pharaoh's house for 40 years, living a secular life, heard his call, decided he would take it into his own hands, murdered somebody, and then spent the next 40 years in the desert. And then when he finally did have, and he did have a multitude of followers, and they followed and complained the entire time they were there, and complained, why have you brought us out here, Moses? Why have you done this to us? Then it goes on and it says, the rest who did it, these deeds, their weakness was turned to strength. What that means is that they were in a weakness. That means that they were feeling weak and so they needed his strength. And they were tortured, they faced jeers, they were flogged, they were chained, they were put in prison, they were stoned, they were sawed in two, they were put to death. They went about in sheepskins, goatskins, destitute, persecuted, mistreated. Where did we ever get the idea that it was going to be easy if we were going to follow God? Where did we ever get the idea that just because you have tens of thousands of people within your church that you're you're doing it right. And I'm not saying they're doing it wrong either. I'm just saying that God is saying, don't look at that and judge your place on that. Because what I felt part two of this was, as I got done with Hebrews, that the Lord in his kindness and love said, you are part of the mosaic of my kingdom. And that I love the heart that rests in Cornerstone because it is my heart. And because you are a part of my upside down kingdom. And then I heard him say, take up your position and be proud. And I heard him say, be proud that this church has a woman as a leader. That is my upside down kingdom. Be proud that the diversity in your leadership of language, ethnicity, and socioeconomics matches the diversity within your community. Be proud and take up your position. And I heard the Lord say that stand in that, take up your position, be proud, but know that it will cost you. Know that when you follow me, it will cost you something. Know that you will be persecuted. Know that people will not like what you do. Know that people will not come to this church because of the gender of the pastor. Know that people will not come to this church because of the diversity of our community. Know that that lives out in this world. And you can't judge and assess yourself by what the world says, but judge and assess yourself by what I say you are in this place. Because when you tear down walls, when we tear down walls, it will cost us. Because when we love fearlessly and when we love people that the church says you shouldn't be loving, it will cost us. Because when we value and respect all people equally, it's going to cost us. Because when we walk into the same grace, we receive God's grace and then offer God's grace in abundance, it is going to cost us. It's going to cost us in time. It's going to cost us in energy. It's going to cost us in pushing. It's going to cost us when people come against us and say it's not right. My good friend, Pastor Phil Carnuccio, gets persecuted because he is friends with me and this church because I am a female leader. He gets attacked by other pastors in the area because he is friends with me. It is real. And what I hear the Lord saying is take up your position and be proud of who you are within my kingdom because Cornerstone, we stand with the Hebrews 11 people. It's just what we do. And as I went along in time and I was talking about the position that we have, what I all just said, there's one more step backwards, and it is taking up our position of who we are in Christ. It's taking up our position of being loved so deeply. Because I know that the more I understand the depth of God's love for me, the more I love others. The more I receive God's grace, the more I pour out grace over others. The more that I walk in who he says I am, the more I want others to walk in who he says you are. The more I dance with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, the more I want to dance with all of you and with this world, because that's who God has called us to be. So as we take up our position, as we stand in who God has called us to be, as we follow him, as we obey, as we are strong in the Lord, it's so important to recognize it internally. And you know, so many of us have lived many of our years as Christians internally and theoretically following God. But then when push comes to shove, we pull back. But faith without works is dead. It doesn't work. And it's important to not only take it up theoretically, but our lives need to match the way that we are saying that we walk. Our lives need to match. I always say I am most spiritual and most loving when I'm sitting by myself in my living room alone with Jesus. Add even a dog and I can get in trouble. You know, I have like 25 dogs at my house right now. So in taking up our position, it is knowing who we are in Christ. It is hearing the call that he has placed on us. It is following that. And then it is stepping out and doing that. We've been talking about fruit, and I loved William's sermon so much because I felt like it was so balanced. And he was talking about the fruit of the Spirit is the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and it develops in us as we fellowship and enter into a relationship because it's the Holy Spirit's fruit. So as we are in that relationship, it should be a part of our lives. But it's not enough just to theoretically go, this is who I am. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, long-suffering, and self-control, gentleness. Dude, you caught the one I missed. Nice. What was I saying now? So all of that fruit needs to be being lived out. And what William said was, yes, it's good. Self-control, that Greek there, that Greek word has an inference that you have the self-control already in you to do what God is asking you to do. But we have to step out and begin walking it out in our life. And we actually have to be doing something. So we recognize our position and then we walk out our position. We own it and take up that position on the inside, and we're going to live it on the outside. And people will know us. How? By our fruit. They'll know who we are. So saying yes is only the first step. The second step is we have to do it. So when I say to you, and I want everybody to pause, when I say to you, take up your position, what am I saying? Outside of our position of who we are in Christ, for you personally, in your life, what is your position? What is he calling you to in your life? Because everybody in this room has a position. Everybody in this room has a place. When God knit us together in our mother's womb, and I do not believe that's physically, I believe that that's a spiritual thing, our personalities, our gifts, our calls, our anointing, all of that stuff that makes us who we are. He said, I am putting you in a world. You are going to touch people that are going to be different because you touched them, and you're going to be different because they touched you. So what is that position that God has called you to? I'm going to pause while you think. What position has he placed in your life? So there are places that we are called to serve in. There are positions that we are called to, jobs that God has called us. You know, I've been realizing lately, I've had a lot of conversations about people and jobs. And I've heard people often say, I just want to do what God wants me to do. If I could just quit my job, I could really serve God. And I'm like, no. We are called to the marketplace. That is a holy calling to be in the marketplace. It is a holy thing to be out there because you all, we all, when we are working in the marketplace, those are people that need to know who Jesus is. It is not about coming into the church. It's about getting out of the church. It's not about doing everything here. This is important. But it's about doing it out there where life is. It's about walking out there and taking up our positions. So if you're in a job, that's your position. If you don't have a job, but you're walking around and talking with people, that's your position. What is your position that God is calling you to? 2 Peter, you know, my verse. I would find a way to throw this in like every sermon that I have. I know I do that. I know. But 2 Peter, because it's so key to our, it's so key. Everything that we could ever need for life and godliness to God has already been deposited in us by his divine power. That is our position that we start in. We start complete. We start as a finished product, and then we work out our salvation, as William preached on. We work out our salvation with fear and trembling. All this was lavished upon us through the rich experience of knowing him who has called us by name. This is why we have our devotions. This is why we read the Bible voraciously. This is why we read other authors. It's so we can have the experience of knowing who God is. This is why we worship. This is why we come together, so we can have the experience of knowing who he is. As we have that experience of knowing who he is, it's then that we begin to understand who we are in him. Once we read that word and we go, I see this here, that has been given to me. Every single promise that you find in that Bible, that has been already placed within you. It is a matter of learning that and working it and understanding who he is and letting that work itself out. We start out done. When Jesus said it is finished, he meant it is finished. We are in him. He is in us. We have what we need. We need to listen, quiet, read his word, discover, and then walk it out in this world. And I have to be honest, there are times that I read the word and I know the truth, and before I can feel anything, before I sense his presence or anything, I have to begin to walk it out and go, this is truth. This is truth. I'm going to walk it out regardless if I feel it or not, because I know, Lord, I know your promises are true. And then it says this, as a result of this, he has given you magnificent promises that are beyond all price, so that through the power of these tremendous promises, do you hear what he's saying here? Peter's just like, do you understand the promises are magnificent? Like these, this is the inference of these Greek words here. They're going like, Peter's like, they're magnificent and they're tremendous. They're amazing promises that we have, but we're living like we're paupers. We live like we don't have these promises. We live in a place that we get discouraged easily because things aren't working out the way that they're supposed to work out. But there's a place in him where there's life and there's hope and there's beauty. There's a place within him that there is truth. There's a place within him that we can find solace in the storm. There's a place within him where we go, I have victory here, Lord, regardless of what's happening in my body, in my life, or in any other way. And it goes, oh, my whole thing just moved down. It's bizarre. And then it goes on and says, as a result of this, he's giving you magnificent promises, blah, blah, blah. You can experience partnership with the divine nature by which you have escaped the corrupt desires that are in the world. Everything has already been deposited in us. We have everything that we need to get through every situation that we could ever face in our life because he is in us and we are in him. We live out of the rich experience of knowing who they, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are. And they call us by name, and they've invited us to come through their goodness, and we learn of their magnificent and tremendous promises through the experience of knowing who they are, through his word, through one another, through worship, through church. And then we escape the corrupt desires of this world. Now I'm going to explain that for one moment. The corrupt desires of this world are everything that tries to pull us away from God. The corrupt desires of this world is every sin that we could ever desire to commit, because when we commit those, he doesn't pull back, we do. Because what we're saying in those moments, you are not enough. The corrupt desires are going our own way because we don't trust them. The corrupt desires are thinking that we know just a little bit more than God instead of quieting ourselves down and saying, what are you saying? The corrupt desires are even situations when we go, I just want to be comfortable. I don't want to go like beyond where I'm actually going to have trouble or hurt. I just want like easy. Why can't life be easy? Right? Don't we all do that? Those are the corrupt desires. Instead of just going, Lord, I'm going to follow you. You know, I shared this in the first service. There are so many lies. There are so many situations. There are so many things that are constantly coming against us that we all hear and that scream in our head. But we have what we need to combat them. There is not an addiction out there that we can't beat. There is not a thing that is out there that we won't win, whether this side or the other. God is victorious. He has given us his divine nature to battle every single thing that we could possibly need. But he calls up to take up our position. You know, this week I I feel like every week I have a story about something that I hit. It's really not a good time, let me tell you. You know, but I hit something that was very difficult for my family, very difficult for me. And just took its toll emotionally, just, it was rough. But in that moment, when I'm watching this whole thing unfold, and I'm you know, terrorized, really. I'm watching this going, I can't believe this is happening. I can't believe that this is happening. It took everything in me that I went, I will fix my eyes on you. I will not look to the left, and I will not look to the right. And I, you know, here I am preaching on take up your position, and I had to stop and go, I will take up my position. And when my mind wanted to go this way, I said, I will not go that way. I will hold here. And when my mind would scream, oh, my gosh, I would go, I will not go that way. I will go here. And you know what? I found peace, and I found him, and I found beauty, and I found love, and I wasn't afraid. And then when I got home later in the day and, you know, my wonderful husband, you know, looked at me to talk to me, I'm like, can't talk. Cannot talk. Because I knew that if I entered orally and verbally what I was battling internally, I knew it wasn't going to be good. And so I said, can't talk. And I just walked by everybody, just went to my own space and just said, I'm going to stand here with you. I'm going to trust you. And then as I went on, then I could talk to him the next day, but not until I could get my mind in a place where I could hear him. Was it a battle? You better believe it. But I got to say, there is peace, there is joy, there is trust, and I am not afraid. Why? As long as I look at him. As long as I focus on who God says I am and who God says every child that I have is. And every person in here is, that's where we have to focus, is on what he says about one another as well. That's where we focus. That is taking up our position. That is knowing and learning and discovering who God is so that we can walk it out in the world. 2 Corinthians 10 says this, although we live in the natural realm, we do not wage a military campaign employing human weapons. We do not use manipulation to achieve our aims. How many times do we all spend hours trying to figure out how to win with something? I'm not talking about planning. Planning is good. Or how many times do we get into, we have an argument with somebody and we go, I'm just going to tell them this. I'm just going to go, that's what I'm going to do. Or how many times do we try to use manipulation, or we go gather our friends around us and talk about that person or whatever so that we feel better. All of that is a manipulation, and God says, don't go that way. It's not helpful. He says, instead, our spiritual weapons are energized with divine power to effectively dismantle the defenses behind which people hide, or to effectively dismantle the rebellious castles. That's another way to put it in the Passion Translation. What that means is we build forts with walls all around it. And God says, my weaponry dismantles the forts. My weaponry of love dismantles those forts. We can demolish every deceptive fantasy and argument that opposes God, and break through every arrogant attitude that is raised up in defiance of the true knowledge of God. We capture like prisoners of war every thought and insist that it bow in obedience to the Anointed One. That is what I had to do. Thoughts, I'm going to captivate you, and I'm going to say, trust him. Thoughts, I'm going to captivate you, and I'm going to make you obedient to the one who is faithful. This is the greatest battle that we have. We all face fears. We all face disheartening moments. We all face relational breakdowns. We all face difficult bosses. We all face stuff that we go, do I have the ability to even do this? Do I even, people have told me such and such and such my whole life, do I even know how to do this? We all are the same and we all face it. And God has given us weaponry that works. God has given us weaponry that brings us into victory. God has given us ability to fight back. And it's not going to be through our fists. It's not going to be through the physical. It's going to be through us standing and saying, Lord, I trust you. Lord, I'm going to follow you no matter what. No matter what you face in life, you have the ability to overcome it. Hear me. No matter what we are facing in our life, we have the ability to overcome it, but it will come at a cost. It will come at a cost of wanting to go into victimization. It will come at a cost of our time. It will come at a cost of getting our own way. It will come at a cost of wanting somebody to get in trouble for what they've done to us. It'll come at a cost that we're going to have to die to ourselves. It's going to come at a cost where we actually have to forgive. It's going to come at a cost of emotional for ourselves. It will come at a cost, but we will be in a place of peace, of love, of joy, of the fruit of the Spirit because of what he's called us to. So taking up our position is not just going, yeah, I'm going to take up my position, and it's, yeah, where you get all emotional. Taking up our position is saying, I will stand, and I will follow you, and I will do what you are calling me to do. That means that if I have a position at a job, then I'm going to go to the job. And I'm going to love the people that you've called me to love in that job, even though they are really pains in the rear end. Taking up my position means the vision that you've given me for my life, I'm going to follow through, and I'm going to do what you've called me to do. Taking up our position means that when I volunteer for something, I'm going to stick a year or two down the road when I really don't want to do it anymore or when I'm feeling bored. Until God says change, you got to stick. Taking up our position means I'm going to serve in the place that you've called me to serve, regardless if I like the people around me or regardless of how difficult it gets, I'm going to stay and I'm going to serve where you've called me to be. Taking up our position means I will take up my position. I will not leave my post. I will say yes to you, and I will do it while loving fearlessly and moving in grace and looking at people and accepting who they are and loving them in spite of themselves. I believe that as a light on a hill that CCF is called to, I believe that every one of us in this space are called to take up our position, especially this year. What is the position that he's calling you to? What is he saying? Don't back down. Finally, Ephesians 6. Now, my beloved ones, I have saved these most precious, important truths for last. Be supernaturally infused with strength through your life union with the Lord. Stand victorious with the force of his explosive power flowing in and through you. Do you hear these words? What this does, the Passion Translation, what they do is they take the Greek word and all the inferences and nuances that are surrounding it, and they say what it's really saying. Instead of stand, therefore stand, it's stand victorious with the force of his explosive power flowing in and through you. We are not victims. We are not losers. We have the ability to overcome every situation in our life. I don't know what the circumstance is or how it's going to change, but you can walk through every circumstance that you might face in victory, in love, and in hope, no matter what it is. It doesn't mean that you're not going to feel bad at times. It doesn't mean that those feelings are not going to be stirred up. But as we stand, he said, stand in the explosive power that God has for you. There is power that's explosive, that is available in every given moment, in every situation that we might find ourselves in this world. We are not victims. We are not in this world. We are a powerful, thank you. We are a powerful group of people in Christ. It's not in ourselves, it is in Christ. So then he goes on to say, put on God's complete set of armor. The armor that is already ours, by the way. the armor that we already have because we are in Christ. And he says, after you've done everything, after you've done everything you possibly can, keep standing. Do you hear that? After you have done everything that you possibly can, keep standing. After you have done, you've prayed and you've fasted and you prayed some more and you stood and you had people pray for you and you've read the word and you've gone into, after you've done all of that, keep standing. Do not give up. As a Hebrews 11 church, as the upside down kingdom, and by the way, I would call us the Motley Crue. In love. You too? And I would be like, Lord, we're like the Motley Crue. So when he said this to me, and he goes, be proud of who you are, and he goes, I never want you to call you the Motley Crue again. He goes, never say that again. He goes, because you are not the Motley Crue. He goes, you are my light on a hill. You are my people. And he goes, you're my lovely ones. He goes, that's what you can call yourselves. God is calling us to stand and to take up our position and to not shrink back and to not turn away and to do the hard road. And I'm not going to say that we're not going to be weeping on each other's shoulders. And I'm not going to say that our weaknesses, we're going to have weaknesses that are need to turn to strength. But can you imagine if we all take up our position, what this place, what this neighborhood, what this state, what this country might look like if we actually take what is inside of each and every one of us in Christ and we begin to live those things out in this world in Him. That's who we're called to be. That's how we're supposed to live. That is the position that we're supposed to take up in this time, in what He is calling us to do and be. So, can we have some music? This is what I want us to do. What is God whispering in this moment? You know, I love that He bathed us with His love, because this is not a message like, if you don't do this, you're bad. This is a message and an invitation to respond to God's love and to say yes to God. What is your position that He is calling you to be? Where are you in your life right now? What is He saying? What is His whisper? And I just want to say this to those who are battling. I don't think a week goes by that I'm not in some sort of a battle, I got to be honest. I really don't. And then if a week does happen to go by that I'm not in a battle, the Lord is placing somebody, one of you or many of you or the whole community on my heart, because I know you're in a battle. But I'm specifically thinking of those who are in a battle, of us who are in a battle. He is faithful. He is big enough. The greatest battle that we have is right here, and we have victory over that. Take up your position of victory. Take up your position that when He was on the cross and said, it is finished, He meant it is finished. Take up your position that when it feels like you're losing, in Him you have victory. In His presence is fullness of joy. In His presence is life evermore. But there's a tuning into that. There's a believing in that. There's a fight for the mind in those moments. What is the position He's calling you to? So let's take a moment. And I invite you to the altar to have any kind of a conversation that you might need with God. And I'm going to invite those who are prophetic, that if you see somebody up here at the altar and you feel like you have a word for them, please come up. Because I got to tell you, getting a word is such a blessing. And even Friday night with that person who did not know us, and I listened to the word again, and I'm like, man, it was a God kiss from God going, you're on the right track, darling. Keep going. Keep going. So the altar is open. And I invite you to come forward as a stepping out, like I was saying, of taking up your position, of a commitment to God, going, I'm taking up my position. I'm going to follow you, no matter how hard it might get, no matter how weak I might feel. I am taking up my position, and I'm following. Altar's open. You know, God never forces us. It's always an invitation. His arms are always open wide, saying, come. There is a place for each one of us. There is a belonging for each one of us. Nobody is left out. Ephesians tells us that he gave good gifts to humanity. He really does. The positions, the place that he's called us to, that's the best place we could ever possibly be in our life. We're going to keep going for just a few more moments, and then we'll close out. Thank you. To give you one update, and that is that my daughter has gone home. And she is returning to work on Wednesday. So God is faithful. Yes. I want to thank Jesus that she has gone home. 31, yeah, Tony goes, me too. 31-year-old daughter living back with you. Love you, honey, if you're watching. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that we are a light on a hill. We thank you that as we leave this space, we're all little lights on a hill. We thank you that you have called us to know who we are in you, and that you've called each one of us to a position and to a call and to an anointing. And you call each one of us to walk that out, always in love, with grace, and in your power. I pray that power over each one of us as we go. Give us eyes to see, give us ears to hear, and give us your anointing to bring the upside down kingdom into this world. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
made up my mind, I got no more excuses. So we open the door and we let you in. I made up my mind, I got no more excuses. So we open the door and we let you in.